3, 2, 1. Yakima for the Pacific Northwest USPTA convention, and it is raining, so we're supposed to be outside here, but I'm sure we got a backup plan. Beautiful setting, really nice, lots of courts.
So what we're gonna do, so
we got Bill working the front desk.
We're going to get you to a place where you can actually log in. Been here before?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, a long time ago.
Probably. Great. Thank you.
Of course.
This is what you can do.
Of course, yeah. I guess I
think this is beautiful. What's up with that?
Guys, remind me your name. Good to see you.
Matt,
Sean,
good to
see you.
Yeah.
Good to see you.
Yeah. Hawaii? Oh, no, I think we did, right? Us Western Washington
people did.
We bring
other stuff.
Yeah.
We bring a lot to the
table, but not rain.
Yeah.
Want to just grab stuff?
No.
Go down there.
No,
go down there.
Yes, see Bill.
There's a process.
Go see Bill. Okay.
I've got to get my stuff.
All right.
Good morning.
Yeah.
How's you guys doing?
Good, great.
Excited and ready to go for the USPTA?
Yeah.
Gonna get out and hit some balls today? If it's nice. Gotta wait for the good weather, right?
Yeah.
Right on. Where are you guys from?
Dallas.
Oh wow, came a long ways.
Yep.
Way to go.
Yeah.
Thanks for the support. All right, we'll see you around.
When you go through the week.
So, good morning.
On your name tag, you should have a QR code. It's on the back. If you're a USPTA member, it looks kind of like these. Okay? And so when at the end of each session, then when we get outside, these will all be hanging on a fence. Right? We'll just pass them around or set them down the row for you. But when you get to the end of the session, if you can't do it now and then leave, just it won't give you credit. So you've got it all figured out. That you will open up your camera and you'll point it at your own tag, and then you point it at this, and then it should come up with a check mark that says, yes, you got 2.25 credits for that session. Okay? If you have trouble, just ask one of us. Right? If you don't have a phone that does that, then anybody's phone can do it. So if you are good at it and your friend isn't, you can also do that. You can do that.
With our first pro here, Sean Brother, who's 30 plus years in the National, is the director of tennis there, of Platinum Information. I was lucky enough to have him move over to our area in Bellingham and kind of semi-retired kind of way. He's helping us out here. Love to have him at our club for 10 hours or so and 15 to play. So, Sean, can you give us our first presentation and everyone give him more welcome?
What do they really want? Do they just want a quick little fix on that forehand because you you're probably never going to see them again? Or is this a person that says, look, I want to really change my game. I want to, you know, give you the modern game. I'm really up for it. You know, test the waters, talk to them, interview them, and find out what's really, you know, what they really want. You know, but if you're going to make any changes with someone like that, you've got to introduce a whole new vocabulary to them, because, you know, what they were taught is, you know, to freeze up, stand sideways, and hold that shape. So, you know, the first thing I try to do is, if I'm going to, you know, sometimes I won't. I may just give them a light tip, and it might just be just trying to get them to rotate a little bit, but they're not rotating at all. You know, getting them to not grip quite as tightly because they're really squeezing the grip. But things that I would do, if I got somebody who's really keen to really want to change the game and really try it a little bit more of a modern forehand, the first thing I like to do is the grip. I think the grip is the starting point to everything. You have to have the correct grip. And there's room for variance. It doesn't have to be semi-Western. Maybe a little more Western if you want to go more Western. Maybe you can go a little more Eastern. So, you know, I want you to put your own stamp on when you're teaching, what you're convicted by, what you feel like is the right thing to do. I don't want to tell you that it has to be a certain way, but the idea that I want to give you is just that, first of all, with the grip, I'll ask them to just put their first finger right in the window of the racket here, and to bounce the ball. And if they can't bounce the ball, you know, I mean, most adults can bounce the ball, but if they can, you can do like a bounce in your hand and then bounce one like this, but most adults can bounce the ball. And they'll do that, and then the first thing once they do that, I'll point out to them, okay, so these are the things that I want to take away. So I want you to think about, you're not squeezing the racket when you bounce the ball. Feel how, you know, you're very relaxed when you're bouncing the ball like that. You notice how even the heel of the hand is detached. I mean, you're not clenching that heel of the hand on there, okay? So, you know, first of all, just get the bouncing of the ball like that. And we're not going to spend a lot of time on that, but just start with that. And then, you know, you can advance, just take the finger out and have them feel that. Okay? So just start with the grip. A couple other things that I have, I got a couple of teaching aids. This is a little Velcro, this blue one's a little Velcro piece, and it has a paper clip stuck in the side of it. So I can move that paper clip and get them to hold the grip where I think they should be holding it. The other one, this black one, has a little hole in it, and I've actually used a little plastic green marker for here for a golf, you get those green markers. They have a little short lamella on them, and I've used that. The thing with these is it's very cheap, and you can, you know, especially if you have like a class or, you know, like, you know, junior program, and you want to give everybody one, it's cheap enough, you can give everybody one like that. But you can buy them, they are professionally made by a company called Encore Off Court, and they cost $6 roughly, so that's quite expensive because they don't last very long. The thing is, the Velcro wears off, so if you buy one, it's going to be good for just, you know, I found it's only good for a few days. If you're teaching all day and you're showing people this, excuse me, you know, for a day, the problem is the Velcro wears off, and you've got to get another Velcro. So. But I like the one they have. It works very, very well. And I love the fact that you can adjust it, and, you know, and I feel like that's really important. It's such a simple little thing that I know all of you here have had the same experience I have with. You can show them the grip and everything, but the moment they go back to hitting the ball, they're going to revert back to their own grip in a hurry. So you're not going to be able to get them to change the grip, you know. I sometimes took a athletic tape and put the racket inside out, so it was the sticky part on the outside, and tried that. Tried all kinds of things to get them, and just never had any success. The moment you turn your head, they would release the grip and change the way they like, maybe have the same grip. So this little thing helps, you know, to try to get them to change the grip a little bit. So, okay, the next step that I want to try to work on is, now that they understand, we're going to try to have, it's going to be a little more the pressure of the fingers, it's not going to be a palm squeezing thing. The next step is, what I try to do is I'll do one or two drills where I'll have them bounce the ball, like we're facing forward, and I'll have them bounce the ball, and then they have to turn their racket around into a more vertical position and try to hit it over the net. So just bounce, hit it over the net, okay, like that. And it can just be like, you know, and this is good for all ages, so, but it just gets them to, it takes away, they cannot be so stiff here, they kind of have to get that elbow moving, they gotta relax a little bit. The other one that I've done is where you just have them trapped against the curtain. So if you're an indoor court and you want you to be trapped and then do it on the curtain, but they struggle with that one a little bit, so they efficiently kind of get up down the court actually. So sometimes they have to be, you know, a halfway decent player to do that. But the bouncing and just hitting the ball over the net like that works really, really well. And that helps get you the grip, it helps you get the rotation, it forces the handle. You know, forces the handle to get out ahead, and they normally just instinctively kind of start loosening up their hips, starting to you know, just relax a little bit. And so it's a good starting point just to kind of get that started. The next step over here is, I will make people do all this with a very short grip, by the way. Like I tried to just go, we don't want to get down the grip too early. And again, it's because when you hold the racket short like this, the awareness of what the handle is doing, I think, helps you. You can see how the handle is projecting out there. And then the moment you get down here, especially if you've got an older person, they're back to the handle behind the body and they're back here again. So they have a hard time getting that little wiggle down and a little arm rotation on the racket like that. So once you've done that, and then the next step maybe is maybe we can move down the grip to about midway, and I'll start feeding the ball to them, and I don't like to feed across the net because I feel like, especially at this point, they need a lot more help. They're, you know, when you step across the other side of the net, you've detached yourself in a big way from them, and you know, you can give them verbal cues, but they've got to be, by that time, they've got to be pretty good, I feel like, before I walk the other side of them. I want to be right there with them, you know, and so I'll be on the same side of the net with them, and I might have, like, I'm standing maybe on the service line, and they're standing, like, right in front of me, you know, they got a group, I might have one here and one here kind of thing, and I like to make them run back, first of all. So it's always going to be running. I never want them just to stand and hit the ball because I just feel like it's more beneficial to teach them to move right out of the gate. So I'll kind of go through with them and they've been working on, now they've got this and this. So now what I want them to do is I'm going to throw the ball landing slightly behind them, and you know, I'll go through with them, we'll rehearse this so they're not going to be cold turkey on this. We're going to be talking about older adults here, so you've got to be very careful. You don't want to get them injured. So we'll shadow it a little bit and say, so the first thing I want you to do is walk away from me. So they say, okay, I'm standing right there. So I want you to turn, and you got to walk away from me. And that racket almost instinctively will go this way. It'll almost instinctively go this way. You can see how I'm holding the racket like this, like, you know, with my other hand right here. I like that because it gets them to do the unit turn a little bit so they're not separating, you know, they get that shoulder movement because the old school, they're like this. They get the unit turn, and you're getting them to actually lift the foot and move, okay? So you're just teaching them, not only are you teaching them beforehand, but now you're getting into a little bit of movement, and I want them moving back. And what I try to get them to do is I want them not to hit it in the court. I want them to hit it over the court. They've got to try to hit the fence or curve on the other side, okay? So take away the moment they're trying to hit the ball to court, they're not free to experiment, they're going to be limited. So give them freedom, say, look, the more you hit the fence or the curtain, I love it, it's better. Okay? So we're going to turn, the racket's going to come into a hug, and you know, again, this is your own sample of this. If you want, you can have them doing the rough and the dull way, have them doing Roger Federer way, Sharapova, Wozniacki. You can, you know, like I said, I don't want to influence on how you're going to teach them, but I want to get, what the message I'm trying to give you is whichever way you want to teach them, I think making them run away is very good because it's unfamiliar for them. Most people, that's the least familiar part for them. And so make them run away, they have to run like this, you throw a little high, And you know, you gotta have to teach them how to time the ball, so when to turn. And then when they get to the ball, I want them to spin around, so they then have to spin and go away from me again. They're gonna spin around, and I want them to keep going away. So I'm trying to just really break them down. You know, remember, because somebody who's, they love to move. They're moving is not in their repertoire, and you're trying to get them to think of tennis in a whole different way. And in a fun way, they have fun with it, you know, just say, hey, you know, this, we're going to try to hit the fence, we can hit the fence, try to hit the curtain, turn around, okay, spin, and then not like this, you go, no, spin, you go shoulder to shoulder, and let it fly, you relax, and just kind of have fun with it too, you know, so don't have a serious tone to it, have a fun, jovial turn, you know, enjoy doing it and fun like that. Young kids get carried away, they'll actually spin twice, you know, get a little too carried away, you go, okay, that's too much, you gotta tone it down, don't get crazy. But once you can start getting them to do that, you'll find that people have a real phobia about going backwards, and they'll feel like they're running into something. So they, and then they do get to, they'll have this phobia. So you gotta make them feel comfortable to hit, and then there's still room back there. They can keep going back, you know. So continue moving a little bit, reversing back. So just going through that. As soon as they, you know. You'll just do enough that as soon as you feel like they don't have to be hitting a little actively, or they don't have to be, you know, they don't have to be doing it well. They just got to get the movement on. You're going to see that they've got this movement going. They're starting to move around. They're starting to get on their toes a little bit. Then you can start doing the other pathways. And I like to go to doing the wide one. And so when you do the wide one, I'll try and get them just sidestepping. So this is very foreign. I mean, they'll know how to sidestep, but they don't know how to sidestep and hit. So again, we'll have them just sidestepping, and they get to ball, they'll hit, and then I'll try to get them to continue sidestepping. So we'll run, sidestep, and then keep moving. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get them to the point where eventually, and this most of the time happens automatically, you don't have to even tell them to do it, but they'll start crossover stepping. They'll do the crossover, and then they'll sidestep, hit, and sidestep again. So your right hits right. So basically the right's always in the lead for a right hand, and your right, hit, right. And that will be the pivot point to come back like that. So it's exciting to teach older people who have never really experienced the modern ways, because they'll be so excited about this. You start bringing this language to their lesson. They'll be telling their friends, oh my gosh, you guys cross up the stepping, never cross up the step. I always turn to run, you know? And there's no more hugging, you start spinning around, and, you know, they'll come back because you're giving them a whole new way of playing tennis. So you will have a lot of success with that. Couple little things with ways to also get them to do it is just bouncing the ball, like, you know, and so again, if you've got a class, you have four people, five or six, you know, try to get everybody active in your class. I don't, you know, if you, I really, really hate to have people wait on somebody. There's one person you wait on, I think it's reasonable. But when you start to wait on two people, that just seems like a long time. You know, by the time it's you, it's like, okay, you know, you lose the energy and the momentum. So if you have enough people like that, create a situation where either they've got 50% of time, they're just alternating, or they're all doing something all the time. So that's where the ball exercises are fantastic. And the, you know, things you can do, simply start out with just a bounce and grab the ball. And they'll cheat, they'll go like this, they'll go like this. You go, no, you got it. The faster you grab it, the more impressive it is. And then you can get them again. You know, you start getting them to turn, to drop the ball, return and hit. And then pretty soon it's going to be bounce, get it up high, make a bigger backswing. So just, you know, just with the ball like that. Do it out of the air. You got to toss, got to grab. And they'll have a hard time with that. They'll struggle with the tossing and the grabbing. And sidestepping, you bounce in the ball. Sidestepping, every time you hit one forehand. So you got to, you know, build on it. And then with the ball, you can get them to go backwards. So again, the ball goes left-handed on the shoulder, they're going to run back. Grab, they're going to reverse. The ball goes forward, they're going to run up. Grab it and go in, all right? You can teach them both ways. You can either do traditional, you can run up. They can think about why they would do the two different methods. It's all about time. At least that's just my take on it. I feel like when people say, well, my coach always said, you've got to turn, you know, to hit the ball. Yeah, well, it takes time. So if you have the time, I agree. I think if you have the time, make the turn, you know. If you don't have the time, then don't turn. And that's what basically happens. If you don't have the time, you end up running, you've got to get that turn, and then there you go. You're back to getting side off again. You can't quite palate it. So if you've got time, you have to do side, 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 grab it, and then you turn forward. So just a lot of ball tossing exercises. And if you've got a group that's cohesive and cooperative enough, they can actually work with partners this way, where I would toss, and they would run, and they would make me run, and you can get very creative with this and do a lot of ball exercises. And then I was going to say, going back to when you're feeding the balls, you know, first you might just have to go backwards, then you start coming forward, so they'll turn, hit the ball, and then they'll be there, and you'll just toss the ball right there, and they'll just run and just do a grab and go, so just grab and just grab and go, and then eventually you can add the white one as well, and then you go to 3 feet, so they run back, they come forward, they recover back, they as soon as they do a ready position hop, now it's wide, they're a side step, hit the ball, and then they can go out and back one like that. So one more thing to do, so now you've gone through basically, you've got them moving and everything. Now that we're going to start a rally going with a friend, I really like to try to use, instead of just using the regular ball, try to use the transitional balls. And I kind of like using the red balls, the big ones, because they have to hit the ball. I like using the red ones, and they have to put more effort into it, and especially if they're older, they can't hit hard enough for them on moving inside the baseline and giving up to the service line if you have to, you know. And again, get them to encourage them to hit the ball out. So because the problem is with the new group, they're going to hit the ball in the head all the time. So the concept of hitting the curtain, or just hitting the ball long, and as soon as they do it, the ball won't go long, it will land out on the service line on the other side. You know, now you can kind of get them hitting. And then as soon as you can, you quickly progress to a fast ball. Go to like a green dot ball. As soon as you get to the green dot ball, then go to finding to a regular ball. And what they realize is, what's going to happen is, especially when you put a regular ball in their hand, they're hitting the ball way off the court. Okay? Now you've opened up the door and says, okay, well now we're going to talk about spin, because that's how you're going to get it in. So we've taught you how to move better, how to hit harder. You've got all the energy now, and now you're going to learn how to spin for control. So you're kind of racking them in a good way, you know, for you to be able to give them good guidance. And so then you can really get them to work with the spin, and they can start appreciating why they need the spin. I've been caught in situations where you have someone who comes and they have very limited power, and they say, why don't you keep your top spin? And I'm thinking, okay, you realize the ball's going to travel even more slowly when you're spinning the ball, right? I mean, you're going to be, you know, you're already telling me you don't have enough power. Now you're asking people to spin, and that, you know. And so it takes a little, you know, and you don't want to discourage them and say, well, yeah, you know, I don't think you're going to be able to spin the ball very effectively, or I don't think it's going to be very beneficial for your game. You have to tread very lightly, and you can, you know, I would take them through these steps and let them do some of these things. And all these things can be moderated, but then the grip might be too radical for them. Even if they don't change the grip, just get the footwork going, get them to go shoulder to shoulder, you know, get them to, you know, kind of get that energy straightening up through the shot a little bit. You can work with these things, and they will discover it as they're going on, that if they find that they don't have enough oomph to put spin in, they'll come to that realization on their own without you having to tell them that you're not going to be able to do it, or that you can get there. Just keep an open mind and you know, see what you can do. So they love learning like that. So that's what the lesson plan there with the older age group is going to be very, very similar for that with the middle school group. And I'm talking about ages 11 to 14. Like, you know, all the things that we talked about with the kind of progressions with the balls works very well for both those age groups. Like that. The ones that's between the middle schoolers and that older group is the high schoolers. And the high schoolers, you know, you're dealing with normally kids that have great energy, great strength, they just need to harness it in a good way. They sometimes have a little mental focus, the concentration isn't as good, so their quality of contacts are bad. They don't repeat the same thing twice. They're very, experimentative in a bad way. You can't get them to focus and do the same thing. But you can, so the things you gotta bring to the table is the same kinds of things where you can start out with the same types of tricks on how to get them to feel the drill and all of that. Most of them normally get that right away. That doesn't take much more than just doing it and go, okay, good. So what you gotta do is really start to testing them a lot with their accuracy. If you're gonna have them like bouncing a ball, put a target on it or a pathway, they've gotta get it in that pathway. Get a rope up so they have to get it over the rope like that. Use some speed criteria where the ball cannot land twice on the ground. It has to land inside the baseline and it has to carry into the curtain, otherwise it's not good enough. Whatever you can do with the high schoolers, challenge them with those things. With the older age group, they're very cooperative. So you can say, hey, why don't you two, I want you guys to work with a rally with each other and we'll do this and that. Or I want you to, bounce the ball and you work with that. You can do that quite successfully, but with the high schooler, not so much. They're not going to be very cooperative. They're going to be wanting to show their stuff. They're going to be hitting the ball too hard, not enough accuracy. So you have to kind of change. The challenges are different, but then you still have to teach them the same things, but you have to think in terms of, so how can I challenge them? And sometimes I just like to time them and say, hey, what we're going to do is we'll have a 30-second challenge. So you get hit with your friend, but we're going to count, how many shots you can make in 30 seconds, or it might even be a minute, like that. So just this constantly monitoring their time. Very little free time to, okay, you just go work on that for a while. No, it's going to be time, we'll time you, put a target, you got a height, and I love the transitional balls, especially in the red balls. Doing that with the high school kids is really, really important, I think. Because they love hitting more, they like the effort, and this allows them to really work hard. And I tried it with our group the other day, as they have been doing it, and I worked with AJ. They just give it a try. And because I'm new at the club, and I thought I'd tell my friend, like, introduce that idea. And yeah, they were a little bit ripples, but as soon as they started doing it, by the time after they started doing it, they left with it and they said, oh, can we do this next time too? They really, really liked it because they loved the fact that they could keep the ball in play, they were working so much harder. So hopefully, kind of grow that more. And again, as you progress, especially when you start getting to the hard balls, you've got to really get them to spin right. But they understand it, and then you don't have to be preaching this. You've got to spin the ball, They're asking, how do I spin the ball? But I think it is. So you're kind of reducing the problem in a good way. So the last one, and I'm at the very end here because time's coming up. They're talking the ages 6 to 8, and we could go obviously lower than that, but their lesson plans change quite a bit. But just a couple ideas on the 6 to 8-year-olds. When they start a lesson, I think most of us will have them do some kind of cardio or some kind of exercise and stuff like that. I try to make everything very tennis specific. The only thing that I'll have them do is typically the first thing I'll do is just have them sprint to the net and back just to wake them up and to get them all listening to me. But then after that, everything we do, I'll try to be very specific to tennis. And so the one of bouncing the ball, grabbing it, pretending to be in forehand, or lifting it and grabbing it, everything with the ball, lots of ball things. I don't have them partner up very much myself because I find they have their own fun, but they're not accomplishing as much as I would like, and you got one kid in the group that's not very cooperative and he's disrupting everybody and stuff like that. So I like to do it more individualized. So just everyone has a ball, everyone is getting to do this exercise. And We typically go through the warm-ups, and my warm-up is I try to just work with the basic steps. Give it the side step, okay, you know, give me cross on the step, you know, show me shoulder to shoulder, show me throwing position, which is also a hug, so I say throwing position, okay, and just give me a hugging finish. So just try to do everything that's going to be something that I'm going to use in the lesson that day. Try to get the language down. And then as far as the getting the concepts of the forehand for that age group, I'll just start out with from this throwing position, we'll just step forward and start bowling. We're just having, you know, like to have the targets. We like to stand the rackets on like that. They love to stand the rackets up and knock them over. So pretty much targets all the time. And we'll just go out with the bowling. And then if you want to, again, this is your personal choice. If you want them to, you know, how you want them, if you want them to lift it up a little higher, if you want them just to drop it down, and try to use points of references. So, you know, the knees and the chin or the ears. I said, hey, let's go just below the ear. Try to come back behind the knee. Whatever you want to teach them, you know, try to, the more you can quantify exactly where you want them to be, use the kind of words that make them very specific. You know, I think makes you a better teacher. You know, someone who is knowledgeable in teaching, at least I feel impressed when I see somebody teach, and they can tell that same sentence to everybody, and everyone's going to understand exactly what you want them to do. To me, that makes one of the qualities of good teachers, that is that, you know, you communicate so clearly that it's hard not to get it wrong, you know, so it's hard to miss what you're trying to say. So as far as the bowling, all the steps, you know, the sidestepping, work with the ball and use the ball to get all those things across. And then once you've done all of that, you do a lot of pop shadow pretend hitting. So again, like, you know, so sometimes I say, hey, you guys are all going to shadow me, and I'm kind of like, what? Okay, you're all going to copy me. You're going to copy exactly what I'm doing. And we're going to just break down the steps. I mean, you guys will do this. But look at them. So when you do a step, make sure you check them. So, you know, don't just do a step, okay, go ahead. Because they're not doing it like right. They're not doing it. So you guys said, look at everyone. Make sure everyone has that step. You know, be very demanding on those parts. I think those are the most critical parts. Because if you can get them to do those things correctly, then your lesson is going to be a lot more successful down the line, because you're going to catch it and you're going to nip it in the bud. So don't have to be, you know, casual about getting exactly what you want, or might need a grip, or things like that. Last of all, yeah. The very last one here is, again, I'll go into just beginning with the other ones, like, you know, not them, going with ball tossing. So once we've done a lot of personal moves, a lot of shadows, and there's going to be a lot of speech and all those directions I work on. So the same concept with the young kids, you know, the same lesson plan. So, okay, guys, thank you very much. And
make sure you hit a lot of balls off the ball machine here, but I'm going to give it up to Jim for a second to talk about the machine. Do you want to bring everybody over to the machine?
Everybody wants to come in, please do, whether you're going to hit or not. I'll go over kind of the features of the machine and show you what's so different about this than any other machine you've had. So come on with me.
I hate when people stand right in front of the ball machine and
you know,
I think I've been hit before.
You should know better. Okay, this is our newest machine. It's called the iGenie. And all the ball machines that you've used previously can throw kind of any shot you want over and over and over and over again. Right? It'll change directions, but it's the same shot. Ground stroke, volley, whatever. The magic here is it throws sequences of shots, similar to what you find in a live ball game. So it'll throw, as an example, a ground stroke to the baseline, a low approach, a volley, and an overhead in sequence. And it'll do it the two different, two lines. So if you want to create a drill for a class that has that skill level, we'll also throw ground stroke, volley, lob. Or, as Kevin likes, volley, volley, lob, volley, volley, lob, over and over again to two lines, or to one line if you're just working on it for yourself. But the magic is the sequence. So as a teacher, you can see the advantages of that to get your students to think about how sequences are so important in their games. If you want to kind of pull back and just work on a ground stroke or volley, so you'll certainly do that too. So a lot more versatility and a lot more fun. So that's what we're going to do here, and I'll blame Kevin for this originally. He's going to work you out. He's given me an idea of what kind of a shot we'll start with. And we'll do ground stroke, ground stroke, ground stroke as you move across the baseline. And he's got a great big target for you that I'm sure you all can hit easily.
He can hit anything.
So that's what we'll do. So do you have any questions about the machine first before I let you go? And does anybody have
price? First question I want.
Yeah.
I've seen them, but I haven't.
They're $8,000.
Oh, wow.
Here's the magic. If you rent it only four times a day, 4 days a week, at $15 a pop, it pays for itself in 7 months. And from thereafter, it drops about $12,000 to your bottom line every year.
Do I throw in a drop top?
Well, it'll throw a version of the drop shot. I mean, I can dial it so it'll do a drop shot. Yes.
But
it's not a shot that's programmed into it.
Jim, I think you said this one is $8,000, but they have other models. So you can go more expensive or you can go less expensive.
You can start at $2,500.
Yeah.
And then there's 1, 2, 3, 4 different increments going up to this.
And do all those other increments have the different patterns that can go?
No.
No.
This is the only one that will do sequences. All the other machines will throw direction anywhere you want, but the same shot each time.
Yeah.
So what's the maintenance plan on it that comes with it? Is there a regular maintenance that needs to happen?
I'm maintenance.
Okay.
I'm your new best friend.
Okay.
And I get to see you every year.
Warranty period?
If you buy it from me, it's 4 years. It's 3 years from the factory, and I add another year onto it.
Okay.
So because of the usage that it'll probably get, you need to have it looked at once a year.
Yeah.
You know how much fuzz they collect, right? So you need to clean them, and what I call preventative maintenance. So I go inside and I look at everything to make sure it's still functioning right.
Jim, can I add to that?
Yeah.
The maintenance thing. So at the Vancouver Tennis Center, we had 9 machines, one behind every court. Every month, these have to be cleaned out a minimum of once a month. You turn them upside down, you vacuum them out, you wipe them down. If you don't do that, you're going to have problems. I guarantee you. It's going to fuzz up like crazy. As you can imagine how much fuzz happens in a month. Clean them on a regular basis.
Yeah. I was going to just give you a pleasant brief. The club I'm at, they have the machine that's used a lot. And we haven't had any problems. I've used a lot of other machines and very problematic. And you know, machine's down all the time. We had, in fact, at one time we started out with one, we ended up with 3 just to keep a machine running. So it always
I
be
know
a good
machine.
Yeah, he inherited them from me. So, but this machine has really impressed me after, you know, dealing with the other machines. And the quality of the shoot that feeds and the quietness of it. So I just kind of give it a positive. I can vouch for it. It's a good machine.
Well, thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
We enjoy about a 90% market share at the club level. And the reason is this: durable, dependable, all day long, every day. And we're the only company that has regional sales and service centers. And I'm the sales and service center for the Greater Northwest. So if anything happens, you call me and I come and take care of it. Any other machine you have, good luck.
Yeah.
And all the clubs that I go to, without exception, if you go to the back room, all of those other machines are back there in parts. And it's just the way it is. So.
Okay, we better get moving.
All right,
we're running out of time. Come on up to the net real quick. Let's work on a couple things. What do you think? Just throw in some stuff to work on. All right, I'm just going to throw out a couple concepts. The house. See the big house? First floor window, second floor window, third floor window. The first window is a drive. Second floor window is a moon ball. Third ball, third floor window is a lob. Okay? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to work on, I'm going to change it up all the time. Line one, line two, line three, line four, and then you rotate over here, pick up 10, throw them in. Hit five balls in one, go to the back of two, hit five balls in two, go to the back of three, and then four, and then pick up 10, and then hustle right back. Okay, and something else to think about. On your trajectory, should the ball be going up or down when it clears the net, or peaking right over the top of the net? Okay, when it clears the net, it should still be going up. If you're trying to hit it deep, it should still be going up. And then it peaks where? Between the net and service line on your opponent's side, because it's not a perfect parabola. It doesn't go like this. It goes long here, and then what happens? Okay, gravity has its effect, and it's shorter on this end. So it's long on this end, shorter on this end. So if you're hitting a lot of short balls, try to hit through that open window, try to make sure it's still going up a little bit, and then make it peak here and bend down into the court. Okay, the number one target to start with is gonna be the big thing. I wanna hear a lot of banging. Okay, go. Line one, line two, line three, line four, we're gonna turn it on, and here we go. I'll take you where you want to.
See the sunshine. six players over there, six players over there, two of you guys over there, over here. So I was tasked with volleys and overheads. You guys are over here. We're not going to be able to do one of the drills. It's too early.
Jesse.
What up?
Where are you headed? Which court?
I guess one, the ball machine court.
Okay. I was already on that one. They sent me to a different one. Okay. I'll catch up with you on two. You'll go to two after that.
Okay.
All right. Hey, Bill.
How's it going?
Good, man. How are you doing?
Just the advanced group? I
think so. You'll be able to tell right away, right?
All right, come on up here, guys. All the way over here. All right, Kamisar, you're going to be my dummer today? You're my dummy. Here we go.
All right, sounds good.
So, first off, I'm Jeff Urey. I'm from Spokane, Washington. I've been director of tennis at the Spokane Club for 10 years. I've been there for 16. It's now going to be known as the Wellness Center at Central Park, so don't be shocked if you go there and there's no more Spokane Club for tennis. So that's just the way it is. I was tasked to teach volleys, overheads, and then put them into a drill. So they said, what do you do on a normal day? Normally, I sit behind the desk and don't do anything, but we said we will show these guys what we're doing. Nicholas has volunteered. He's going to jump out here. We normally don't have 12 or 16 people out here unless it's a cardio tennis type thing, but with this, the restrictions we're under, it's going to be volleys and overheads. So we're going to do some different drills and just kind of show you what we do on a day-to-day basis. If I have one person out here, like Nicholas is out there, so one of the things we like to do is just going to volley and you're going to hit it right back to me, but I'm just looking for a nice hit right back to me. So I'm moving, he's hitting the split steps, he comes to his backhand. I'm looking to see if he's stepping in. He's stepping in. He's hitting his forehand or his backhand. Just mixing them up like that. Give me somebody else out there. Chad, jump out there. So you're out there too. So as we transition from that, we can say start right in the middle there, guys. And what we're going to do is we're going to do a 3-3. We're going to go forward, come back, and check right behind you. So this is a drill I like to do with the doubles team to get them moving. We're going to have them moving as I feed the ball. We're going to have them hit a shot, so we're going to have a purpose with the volley too. So we're going to say keep it in front of you, so if you can post to your right, keep the play in front of you as you go there. Chad, you're right behind him doing the same thing. Ready, and go. Chad, you're in. You're in. Go this way. Go. Go. Now you're moving in your back. Go. Now it's to a lefty warrior. Go. Keep it in front of you. Go. Nicholas, like that. So they're working right there on the move. Ah, he's moving in. So after you hit it, you're recovering back.
Yeah,
and
right.
Nicholas, go. Warrior, go. Back it up. Good. And go. And then in. And then in. Go.
I saved you.
I'm not even tired. I can do this all day. Here you go. Chad, go. Here you go. Good. Something very simple like that. They get a hell of a lot of balls. They get the move. Let's get into teams of four. Teams of four. So four people on a team. Everybody on that side of the net. Everybody on that side of the net. Teams of four. Jump out there, guys. Or if you just want to watch, you can watch.
Chad's not even breathing hard yet. Can we make sure he does something?
I've seen more excitement at a gender reveal party. Come on, guys, let's go. Get out here. By the way, I'm ready to reveal my gender later. You guys are up here at the net. We're going to be up at the net. So,
get 3 feet. Nick. Catherine.
Nick. One of your people is going to be on this side, sorry. So you're going to have to go right there, Chad. Nicholas, you're right behind you. So here's what we're going to do. You're going to have one person on your team. Guys, you're going to have one person on your team on this side. Back it up a little bit, Chad. And this is called roly-poly volleys. You're going to hit one volley to me, you're going to move out, and Nicholas is going to move, and Catherine's going to move. So it's boom. Moving in. Moving in. Just like that. Nice. Just like that. Just like that. If you miss it or whatever, just pick it up and get it going again. That, so you miss it, so what? You get another ball. So one person on each team on this side kind of controlling, and we're going to have a little competition. So one person on each team on this side, the rest of your team's over there.
Are you feeding too, Chad?
I'm the one person.
Ah, gotcha.
So the people on that side, you're working on moving in, getting your volume, sidestepping back out. What you don't want to do is...
I'll be right here filming from behind and the side. I know, you're a lefty. I know that. I know. Yeah.
Back to head. You're going to move in, you're going to hit. your sides of the bounce. So if it does come back, so you can still
get all three of you.
Back as hard as you need to. The team moves up, you can feel them behind it. Rolly, fully mode. Ready? Go ahead, practice. All right. Okay, you guys have the idea. Hold the ball. Competition now. You guys are going to go for 30 seconds. And how many you can get. Every time it goes over the net, it counts as one. Ready, Mark? Get set, go. Every time it goes over each side, Chad.
Oh, got it.
Wow, look at Catherine.
5 seconds.
Rocking
5 seconds.
Okay.
And time. How many you guys get?
26.
26. How many did you guys get? Different player over here. Switch them over. Another player.
Well done. I like that drill. That's a good drill.
Anything over the net. That's it.
Counts as one.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. On your mark, get set, go. 30 seconds.
24.
I've been authorized by the USPTA, whoever had the most points combined out of this thing gets a free membership at Chad's Club.
Woo!
Weird.
Wow.
On your mark, get set, go.
I should be playing.
5 seconds. Good. And time. 10 points. There's no clean winner clause. If it's up to the middle without intention, we'll give you 2 points. But other than that, if we're having an elimination where there's like 6 or 8 people, only that side they had a clean winner to be saying we knocked the champs down. The champs are a big deal. But we're just trying to get more players in. Okay, here we go. Chad, let's go. That's a clean winner. You're gone no matter what.
Wow.
New champ.
5 minutes.
Here you go, Nicholas.
You're on your 5 minute wrap up.
You got it.
Oh, oh. Right, Clyde, 1-1. Good shot. Go, Nicholas. Oh,
okay.
I'm sorry. Counting to 1, 2, 3 is always a tough one. Here we go. Ready and go.
Oh, winner.
Clean winner. Clean winner.
Oh, no.
Quick repeat on a
shot. Here
we go. Ready on the move. Go.
Throw the racket out of there.
Get it down, switch him.
I'm moving, you!
Gone, baby, gone. One. Championship point.
You.
Nice!
Whoa!
Starting now, your team loses, start picking up balls. Here we go.
Oh, man.
Well, those guys are good.
0-1, switch him, go Chad, on the move.
Uh-oh. She's got it. There it is. Shot, Chad. Ooh, nice forehand. Whoa. Yeah. Excellent.
Yeah, you gotta be kidding me!
Chad, you guys are back up for the championship. You have 3 points.
Nick Catherine.
Bragging rights on a Friday afternoon.
Pressure.
Here it goes. Game on.
All right. Oh, I was going for the winner right away.
Yeah,
all right. 1-1. Championship point. Left-handed. I'll give him left-handed.
Oh, thank you.
And there it is.
Daniel.
I've got a racket.
Daniel.
Three teams, four.
So I've got. You guys are in. I need another team. I got Phil.
Yep.
One more. One more.
Tato.
One more. Just one player.
Where's Phil?
Where's your racket, Phil?
Sean Soriano right there.
We've got them.
I heard the call.
Thank you. You're with these guys. Not a bad group to be with.
Anna. I need one more.
Not bad.
No. Lucky to be with them. So you're with these. Yep. All right. So the easiest way to explain this is we're serving and returning, right? The goal is for the returner to get 6 points across the net cross court. How you get points, it has to be cross court as a returner. If you go cross court past the service line, it's worth 2 points. If the server double faults on you, it's a point for the returner, right? So, an ace by the server is -1 for the returner. So we're gonna hold you a little bit accountable, right? So, the team that wins is the team that actually gets their 4 returners all the way through, right? And then we'll, after the first round, we'll change the variation and we'll just talk about the many variations that you can do off of this. Any questions? No? All right, you guys are taking on these guys. over there. So you are not serving to your teammate. You are serving to one of the other guys. Right? Six. So everybody serves on this side. One person from each team over there.
We'll see in a little bit, Tommy.
Only one of you. You guys are serving. The rest of you are serving to the other team.
Yeah. Oh, we got one.
I'll return. You get a first serve. You guys get a first serve and a second serve if needed.
So you're just playing two players going cross court, is that correct?
Are we playing the point?
That's what I want to know.
We're just serving and returning.
Hey, we're not playing it out though, right?
No. Well,
all right.
So I think when your returner gets 6 points by returning.
Jeez, first serve. So you're keeping track of your points. You got one. Yeah. Get him, Daniel. Nice serve.
Oh, second serve.
It's called Jess.
Oh. So he can only hit it to his forehand? What? That's wild.
Dang it. Come on, Craig.
Have you returned one yet?
Get him.
Not today.
Oh, winner.
How many is that, Craig?
How many yet? Five?
Craig, four.
That's my name. That's a nice serve. Sweet.
Yeah.
Nice
storm. Nice one. Stay down.
Watch that ball behind you, guys.
So you're at three. Out.
Don't give him a freebie, Jesse.
There it is.
2 points.
Excellent.
I got lit up. Oh no, he's on us.
Bill, if you get your first serve in, you're on us. Oh, we have a question. Woo! Minus one, right?
All right,
one of you has to go over.
Or do I lose the point for missing the
return? No, it's the
same. I got over before you.
Well, it was close. Oh, I was actually jogging over.
I was getting my score maybe.
Doubles with
me. Oh yeah, get the help.
Are you guys playing Washington State?
What's that?
Gonna play Washington State?
Over 40.
Oh, that's right, on a team. Yeah, good luck. You guys are going to the Nationals after that, right? Are you on a team, Phil?
I think we might still have one more. You haven't gone over yet, have you?
Two more to get over still?
One more?
Okay. That's my lesson
today. Fire now, yeah, show them. Show them those bastards.
Wow, that was a nice kicker out wide.
That on video,
yeah,
right?
I did. Phil still got it. There you go. Good one, Bill.
Do you guys have anybody else to go over? Darn it.
Woo. Where's that been?
It's just warming up.
Pressure.
There you go.
So we're gonna now, if you were serving on this side, you're now serving on this side, and we'll go on one serve only.
Oh, okay.
You feel good about your second serve?
Yeah.
All right. When the F-bomb comes out first, it's like, oh no. So your still point total is the same. You need six, right, for the return. Okay? Alright, so each team needs to send a return over, and you're returning on the different side. Let's go, we gotta get all four returners through.
He hasn't returned yet.
No, you're fine. You can go in front or on the. I know how to edit.
My 30 seconds of fame.
Blame it.
Are we doing doubles or singles?
Either one.
Nice.
So every time you get a point, if it goes in, is that correct?
If it goes in, they have to make their return.
Oh, that's a good one. Cross court
to get a point, but to get past the service line.
Past the service line. Got it.
I might not be your double start anymore.
Well, because if I missed the 10, it's a blank game over. Yeah.
Boy. That's
enough. Needed a returner.
Oh my god, only one.
I'm doing it. My kicks can look just a good time. Okay.
Whoa. Oh,
whoa. Nice.
That was an awesome serve. Yeah, you got a nice serve.
Up.
Body.
Good serve.
Yeah. Woo! The rack has speed.
I love that. I need more stuff like that. That's good B-roll stuff.
That's me that will do that.
Yeah, I'll put you in the highlight reel for that one.
Well, that seems like a cheap return.
One serve is tough.
Yeah. In the basket. Whoa, that was money, man.
Slightly.
Not by much.
Sam, you're over. Go.
You guys are sending somebody over.
Yeah.
Oh, that was it.
Good serve. Max is on fire today. Getting a lot of good serves in.
Battery's left-handed. Come
on. Gotta be to the back end. So you gotta be aware if he's a righty or a lefty.
My favorite server in this one.
Three. How many do you guys have to go? Alright.
We'll do one more variation.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Jesse, are you over here now? Where are you teaching at? Oh. Oh, I thought you were Jesse. Sorry. That's Jesse.
Oh, that's clean.
Nice.
Nice done. Tough. That's tough. Got him with the kicker.
I don't even have a kick to Avery.
You probably never seen that before.
Nice shot.
I just developed that in the last 6 days.
I should have had you guys flip sides.
Ooh, ouch.
You guys did that side last time, right?
Two, it's on the line.
Oh, on the line means one.
Lines are in. Get off me!
Go, Craig.
Just own it. Just no problem. Just John McEnroe.
Yeah, let's do that. Definitely. There was
Johnny
a net
Mac.
Person there.
Yep, just gonna chip for deep. You're right. Yep. Gotta come over the ball now. No slices.
So you must be a Craig too. Is that right?
Yes.
Craig. Nice to meet you.
Oh, clean!
All right.
Clean! Tough! Six in a row!
Did you say Oregon?
Yes.
Awesome. Sun River.
Hood River.
Hood River.
Oh, this is it, boys?
All right.
That's what size, Craig. You put it outside.
Dude, let's do it.
That's clean, Avery. Just owns it. Oh, it's two. Oh, nope.
Try the two. Try the slice.
Oh,
it's only one.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
It's only one. Oh, they got to touch the car.
Are you guys done?
Touch the card!
Alright, we have our warnings, we gotta pick up the ball, and then we'll wrap it up before we go. There are so many different things we can do with this. We can do like backhand slide only or topspin only. You could do so many variations of it with the returner. You can try to work on second serves and short ball return. You can mix it up however you want. There's so many options.
Do you ever get into doing a plus one or playing any points out?
So just for like the sole purpose of working on serve and return and the numbers dictate kind of like if you want to play it out. Maybe if you only had three on each team, smaller group to play it out. But the purpose was to hold accountability for the serve and the return. So let's get them up and then we'll wrap up with the group. Good work, you guys. Thank you.
You guys working on that cease to pause one-handed backhand? Oh, you have a two-hander. Djokovic. Is that the Ultra Pro, the new one?
Yeah.
I like that racket a lot. And Daryl, what are you playing with?
Head Prestige.
Aha. That was my college racket.
That one's
What tension are you using? 53. And what are you using? 52? 16 gauge, 17 gauge? Trying to hit the line?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Nice.
All right. Everybody else,
we're still
line.
Aiming for the alley.
Still going over the alley. So if we were super, super crowded, I could put another lane in the middle with throw down line.
Another lane with a 4.5 foot target.
We're still aiming for the alley. This is how it's going to work. One of you, Alejandro, is going to be my first volley. You're going to be on deck out here.
Taylor, you stand for two.
All right, everybody else is in the line.
You miss your out.
Four, again, it's four hands
as
only.
As you're hitting it in the
Taylor's
alley,
Taylor's going to hit send two, that first ball to the end of your Alejandro, every time the volleyer's ball lands in the alley, it's 1 point for your team. Taylor, you stand for two. If you miss, you're out. Right, as long as you're hitting it in the alley, you always stay for two, then rotate to the end of your line. So stay. Count every ball that lands in the alley from the volleyer.
How about the volleyer? Do we stay two?
The volleyer is going to stay for six and then rotate. Volleyer stays for six. Any more questions?
But if I miss, I got to rotate.
No, not. You stay for six balls.
Okay.
Vegan!
There we go.
Oh yeah, I forgot I got a lefty over here. Oh, Yuri, looking good. There we go. All right. There we go. And then new player. Cam, I like that move. Nice effort. There we go. All right.
To clean them, and what I call preventative maintenance. So I go inside and I look at everything to make sure it's still functioning right.
Jim, can I add to that?
Yeah.
The maintenance thing. So at the Vancouver Tennis Center, we had 9 machines, one behind every court. Every month, these have to be cleaned out a minimum of once a month. You turn them upside down, you vacuum them out, you wipe them down. If you don't do that, you're going to have problems. I guarantee you, it's going to fuzz up like crazy. As you can imagine, how much fuzz happens in a month. Clean them on a regular basis.
Yeah, I'm going to just give you a pleasant reason. The club I'm at, they have the machine that's used a lot, and we haven't had any problems. I've used a lot of other machines, and very problematic. And you machine's down all the time. We had, in fact, at one time we started out with one, we ended up with three just to keep a machine running, so it always be a good
machine.
Yeah, he inherited them from me. So, but this machine has really impressed me after dealing with the other machines, and the quality the quality of the shoot that it feeds and the quietness of it. So I just kind of give it a positive. I can vouch for it. It's a good machine. Well,
thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
We enjoy about a 90% market share at the club level. And the reason is this: durable, dependable, all day long, every day. And we're the only company that has regional sales and service centers. And I'm the sales and service center for the Greater Northwest. So if anything happens, you call me and I come.
Come on, Hawkins, let's see it, man. Quit messing around, let's be serious.
I love that commentary. Survivor, it's great. Man.
That's a winner. How you doing, bud? Good.
All right, Jeremy, knock that target down.
With a lob?
Why not?
Hey, now we're gonna go back to drives, okay?
Drives.
Drives this way, we tossed the lobs both ways, now it's gonna be a drive to that corner through the first floor window. Now I'd like you to step in and take the ball to the top of the bounce and drive it. Hit it with some authority. Pay attention to the peak of your arc, guys. Nice. On through.
Forward, nice.
Five balls, guys. Five balls.
Start. I keep hitting four.
There it is. Oh, nice shot.
Yeah.
He's got very smooth strokes. Wow. You have nice strokes.
Thank you. Two guys here. You're heading inside out for you.
Yes. So windy out here. Remind me of my college match over in Spokane. It was like blowing 35 out.
A younger man would have had it, Gerald.
Oh yes, nice.
Nice shot. Great shot.
Oh, okay.
Oh no.
Here we go. This one's yours. There it is. Nice.
Two.
Accelerate, guys. Let that racket pick up speed. Slow and crisp. A lot of racket hits, guys.
Go.
Throw the racket at him.
Get out, switch him.
I'm moving. You.
Gone, baby, gone. One more. Championship point.
You.
Nice.
Starting now. Your team loses. Start picking up balls. Here we go.
Oh man.
Well, those guys are good.
0-1, switch it, go Chad, on the move.
Uh-oh. She's got it, there it is.
It's over. 1-1, switch it.
Shot, Chad. Ooh, nice forehand. Whoa. Yeah. Excellent.
Oh, you gotta be kidding me!
Oh, no. No, that's new. Sorry. Chad, you guys are back up for the championship. You have one point. Thanks.
Nick Catherine.
Bragging rights on a Friday afternoon.
Pressure.
Here it goes.
Game on. All right. Oh, it's going for the winner right away.
Yeah, all right. 1-1. Championship point. Left-handed. I'll give him left-handed. Oh, thank you.
There it is.
And again, thank you guys so much for being here. Really been a fun weekend. Drive safely home, and we'll see you soon, I hope. All right, thanks a bunch.